This video is about a simple active bandpass filter. It corresponds to the first part of section 24.4 in applied analog electronics. Okay, let's start by looking at how we build an active bandpass filter. It is an active filter, so we're going to have an op amp. And because this is easiest to do with an inverting amplifier, the positive one will just go to VREF. For the negative input, we will have a DC blocking capacitor and a resistor. So let's call that CI and RI. For the feedback, we'll be putting them in parallel. Let's call that RF and CF. All right. Now we need to figure out what is the gain of this amplifier. Well, the gain of an inverting amplifier is just a negative of ZF over ZI. So we're going to end up with this parallel impedance on the top and this series impedance on the bottom. So that's on top minus 1 over 1 over RF plus J omega CF. And then on the bottom, we will have RI plus 1 over J omega CI. And that looks pretty messy because we have fractions inside of fractions. We can simplify things quite a bit if we take this part and move it down and multiply top and bottom by RF. Let's just do one step at a time here. So minus 1 over 1 over RF plus J omega CF, and that's times RI plus 1 over J omega CI. And we could simplify this thing if we multiply top and bottom by RF and by J omega CI. So that's minus R minus J omega RFCI, and then this is going to be 1 plus J omega RFCF, and 1 plus J omega RICI. All right, that is the general form for the gain of this amplifier. What we want to do is to look at several different things. I'm going to claim that this is a bandpass amplifier, and perhaps it'd be, before we go looking at the details of that, let's just plot this thing with Gnuplot to take a look at it with some typical examples. So what I've done here is to set up Gnuplot, loading the definitions, setting an X and Y range, and then defining a bandpass filter as just using the definition minus the impedance of the feedback impedance. So that's in parallel RF and the capacitor of size CF. Divide that by the input impedance RI plus, and then here's ZC of FCI. So having done that, I can now plot that. And I picked some reasonable values here just to get a plot. So 10 kilo ohms, 100 nanofarads for the input impedance, and 10 kilo ohms and 10 nanofarads for the feedback impedance. And that gives us a plot that looks like this. So we've got things that we expect here. We've got a nice straight line coming up here, nice straight line coming down here, and a bit of a flat spot here on the top. And so what we want to know when we do a filter like that to approximate it is, how do we approximate this line? How do we approximate this asymptotic line? And how do we determine how high that flat spot is at the top? Where does it peak? So let's go back to paper and try figuring that out. So we're going to start with the formula that we already have, this one. And we can get the two asymptotes fairly easily because we can look at what happens as omega goes to zero, what happens as omega goes to infinity. Actually, it might be a little bit easier to do one more thing to this first, and that is to multiply this thing out on the bottom. It's not immediately simpler, but it will get simpler in a moment. So on top we have minus j omega rf over ci, or rfci, and on the bottom, well, we'll have the real parts, 1, and then the two imaginary parts multiplied together will give you minus omega squared R sub F C F R sub I C sub I, and then the two imaginary parts separately, plus J omega, and then we'll have R F C F plus R I C I. Okay, and that's the whole thing there on the bottom. So that doesn't look simpler, but we've got the real part and the imaginary part separate now, rather than having to multiply it out. What happens as omega goes to zero? Well, as omega goes to zero, this omega squared goes to zero, this goes to zero, and we've got a 1 on the bottom. So we can write that as omega goes to zero, the gain goes to minus j omega RFCI. And that's the line that we wanted there at the beginning. We've got something that grows with frequency. And there's a corner frequency here that seems to be, well, we'll worry about the corner frequency in a moment because it's a little bit trickier than it looks. What happens as omega goes to infinity? All right, if we go back to looking at this, on the bottom, the omega squared grows faster than anything else. The 1 and the j omega don't grow nearly as fast. So as omega goes to infinity, we can approximate it just as this thing on the bottom, just the omega squared term. And then we can take a look at what's top and bottom, cancel stuff out, and we get that the gain goes to, and we will have RFCI over omega, sorry, that's j times RFCI, over omega times RFCFRICI, which is J over omega RICF. So this has again got the form we expect to see. It's a line sloping down. It's proportional 1 over frequency. And again, we know where it is. This one depends, going up dependent on RFCI, coming down depends on RICF. So we've got those two asymptotic lines. What about the peak? Well, where the peak is going to occur is where the real term here goes to zero. And I'm not going to derive that for you. Just ask you to take my word on it, but it is possible to derive it. If you really want to do it, you can take derivatives with respect to omega and find out where it becomes zero. And so what you have then is that omega squared is equal to square root, or 1 over square root, of RFCF RICI is where the peak occurs. And we should probably figure out what the gain is at that peak. And so probably the easiest way to do this, you can see that this real part will go away there. So at that point, we will have minus j omega RFCI over j omega RFCF plus RICI. And we can cancel the j omegas. So this is the peak gain. And it's a purely real number, minus RFCI over RFCF plus RICI. So that's pretty simple. And if you wanted to see this clearly, you can make a function that's got this at the low end, this at the high end, this in the middle, and see that it touches nicely on the curve in Gnuplot for the actual gain. So this is these approximations. Got the nice curve there, and you've got straight line, straight line, straight line that all matches nicely. I've not drawn it very well here. And what we're interested then usually is where are these two corners, the two corner frequencies, to kind of characterize the whole thing. And you can figure out what that is by looking at where does the peak gain equal the asymptotic gain. Now, where's they're not going to be the same gain because this is purely real and these are purely imaginary in the asymptotes. But if you look at the magnitude of them, so the minus J and the minus sign here don't really matter. And so we're looking for where does omega RFCI equal RFCI over RFCF plus RICI. And we can see that that's just omega equals 1 over RFCF plus RICI. And that's going to be this corner where the first line meets the horizontal peak. And then to get the second one, we need to look at where again, this gain is equal to this gain, or the magnitudes of them are equal. So 1 over omega RICF equals RFCI over RFCF plus RICI. That's easier to do if we flip both things upside down. And so we have omega RICF equals RFCF plus RICI over RFCI. Divide both sides by the RICF, and we'll get omega equals, and we'll have RFCF over RFCI RICF. So got all of them on the bottom. That'll give us just 1 over RICI, and this one will give us just 1 over RFCF. And that's where the second corner is. So this is the low corner angular frequency is 1 over the sum of the two time constants, and the high corner frequency is the sum of 1 over the time constants. So that basically gives us a way, given any of these active filters, to get a quick view of where's the corner frequencies and what is the peak gain. And the slope of the two asymptotes here are basically one decade per decade going up, one decade per decade going down. All right, that's it for the initial part of this. We'll do a separate video on not analyzing one of these filters, but designing one.